Hi, everyone. I'm Stan Mallow, the Paranormal Yakker. My guest today is Charles Lear. I'll be speaking with him about his book, The Flying Saucer Investigators. It's about the people involved in the mystery of the flying saucers, mostly the investigators, but also the witnesses, some of whom were profoundly affected. His main interest in the UFO subject are in the documented history the phenomenon has spawned and the people who investigate. Charles's other interests are geology, paleontology, and various aspects of the theater. Charles Lear, you are a true Renaissance man. Welcome to Paranormal Yakker.
Thank you very much, Stan. Pleasure to be here.
The period covered in your book, Charles, has been referred to as the golden age of flying saucers. What period of time was that?
I go from June 24th, 1947, reported sighting by Kenneth Arnold of nine objects. I described them as flipping like fish and flashing in the sun, then later described them as moving as if you skipped a saucer on water, and then up to 1969, the termination of Project Blue Book.
What, Charles, transpired during that time frame to earn it the distinction of being called the golden age of flying saucers?
Well, they were still calling them flying saucers throughout most of that. Stan Friedman continued calling them flying saucers throughout most of his career. And there was an innocence among the investigators to some extent. There was the hope and possibility that at any time, the answer was just around the corner. It made it a special time, and it was an age of discovery and the investigators finding their way. So I think there's a lot of magic in there.
You cover in the flying saucer investigators a wide range of personalities who are involved in exploring and investigating the UFO phenomena. This ranges from serious science-minded individuals to out-and-out mischief makers. Could you give me some examples from each of those categories?
One of the very earliest groups to form was civilian saucer investigators. I think that was maybe 1951, but a lot of the serious organizations started around 1951. Aerial Phenomena Research Organization started in 1951. That was Jim Lawrenson and Coral E. Lorenzen. Coral E. Lorenzen was the main driving force between that. That was her major interest. CSI New York, both those organizations approached the mystery from a science angle. Coral Lorenzen was one of the first that I could see in the record. They put out a publication throughout their history called the APRO Bulletin. It lasted until 1988. So it's a very long-lived organization. And there was a case up in Connecticut where something crashed through a sign and left trace metal. Coral Lorenzen actually got some of that metal, sent it out to be tested. It turned out to be really pure copper, and it's likely that some wayward ordnance crashed through the sign, but nobody owned up to it. So from the get-go, APRO used scientific methods to look into this. On the other side, Gray Barker was a native of Clarksburg, West Virginia, and he started off, his very first investigation was the Flatwoods Monster case near Sutton, West Virginia. So it was right in his hometown. And he got asked by the publishers of Fate magazine if he would be willing to investigate the case. And he did. He went out with a tape recorder, interviewed witnesses. He was a really good investigation on his part. And he wrote about it in the article for Fate. And also, this was 1952. And then in 1956, he published a book, They Knew Too Much About Flying Saucers. By that time, Barker had gotten a lot more whimsical and seemed to have approached the subject more from the folklore point of view. Also, he was a self-confessed frustrated writer. So this gave him a subject to where he could play. He's actually a really poetic writer. Some of his stuff, it's just really touching. Ultimately, like They Knew Too Much About Flying Saucers really reads. He puts a lot of drama in there, but he was much more whimsical. And then later he teams up with James Mosley. James Mosley started an organization called Saucers Society. They put the name to it later, but he put out a publication called Saucer News, eventually morphed into Saucer Smear. And he was much more into the gossip and the personalities. And he and Barker would get together and they were drinking buddies. So they would indulge. And they pulled a few pranks on the UFO community, flying saucer community. A famous case is where a friend of Barker's father worked at the State Department. So this guy got a hold of a lot of State Department stationery. And he and Mosley wrote a bunch of letters and sent them out to various organizations. One to APRO, advising them to cease operations because a postal crackdown was coming. But the most famous one was what's become known as the Straith letter. They wrote to James Adamski, praising him for his work, saying that they support the State Department supports your work, but we can't publicly admit it. And it was signed R.L. Straith. And Adamski and his followers held this up as corroborating his claims. And this ruffled a lot of feathers in the among the other investigators. And the hunt was on to figure out who had perpetrated this. And it seemed the Lorenzans over at APRO got a pretty good idea that they don't name him, but they say, whoever it is, this boy is sick. So that would definitely be that they were the libertine mischief makers more than anybody. Mosley became known as the jester of ufology.
Which UFO encounters did you find to be the most credible, ones that even hardcore skeptics would have difficulty debunking?
The cases of there, one chapter I wrote is called Overt Contact. And all of a sudden, people were getting zapped and burned by these beasts up in the 1960s. One striking case was in 1964. It sort of fell through the cracks because everybody was looking at Socorro at the time, the Lonnie Zamora case. So this young kid, Charles, I think he was 8 or 9, was playing out in front of his grandmother's laundromat. He sees this black top-shaped object about 5 feet tall across the street. And he gets this sense that it's aware of him. And he moves to the left, it moves to the left, he moves to the right, it moves to the right, he moves back again, it moves back again. And then all of a sudden, it comes towards him with such speed that he braces himself. He thinks it's going to go right through him. And it stops right over his head. Flame shoots out the bottom and catches his hair on fire. And his grandmother is witnessing this at the time. He runs into the laundromat. They put out his hair. Grandfather drives up. They tell him what happened. Off he goes to the hospital. He was in the hospital for 2 weeks and took another 4 weeks to recover. His face swelled up to where his nose reportedly disappeared. His ears were turned inside out. And the strangest thing is that he was very itchy, but he reported other than that, no pain. The only lasting damage was hearing loss in his left ear, and he had to wear glasses for the rest of his life. Now, there are tapes made by James McDonald, who was a very prominent astrophysicist, who one of the first prominent scientists to go public beyond flying saucer publications into the mainstream press and argue on the side of scientific investigation of flying saucers. So he interviewed them, and those tapes are on file in the archives of the University of Arizona. So you can hear Charles's testimony. This is a couple years after the fact. I think he's 12 at the time. You can hear the testimony of Charles. You can hear the testimony of the grandmother, of the mother. And there are newspaper accounts of this story. The FBI investigated. They never came back with any results. They took his burned shirt and tested it, but they never gave his grandmother or his mother any of the results of their investigation. So that, to me, that just, what in the world was that? You know, what would burn a young kid like that? Military? Why? And why would it be there in the neighborhood, you know, where it could do that kind of damage? Why would an alien do that? So it's a very strange case. There are a lot of other cases like that around the same period. Another 11-year-old boy, I think his name is Chris Wells, tube came out of, he saw a large red glowing object and a tube came out of it and zapped him in the arm, caught his jacket on fire and burned his arm. His grandmother, again, witnessed this. No, it was his mother. His mother witnessed this, saw the object, saw his jacket on fire and took him to the hospital. Now, there were medical records of these events. So you've got trace evidence and you've got medical records, but the investigators didn't collect them, photograph them. There's probably some legal reason why they couldn't collect them, but it's just a shame they weren't preserved in any way, because that would be on top of the witness account, the trace evidence, and the documentation. You've got a really strong case there, but I still think they remain strong cases, and they're still, they leave me wondering.
The U.S. Air Force investigated UFOs and put their findings in Project Blue Book. Supposedly, it was to inform the public about the truth of the UFO phenomena. We now know they were not totally honest in their writings. What were the findings of your research into Project Blue Book?
What I saw is it depended who was in charge, how they felt about the phenomena in general, the mystery. Were they open to the idea that this was something, about that these were aliens driving ships or something else interacting with us that we didn't understand, that had consciousness? So when Captain Edward J. Ruppelt, he was the first person in charge of Project Blue Book. He only lasted a year before his term of service was up, till he was discharged. But he was tasked, before Blue Book was Project Sign, then Project Grudge. Project Sign, they were open-minded, issued a report, I think it's known as the Twining Memo, saying they thought that these were alien craft piloted by aliens. And this got crumpled up, thrown into a wastebasket, and nobody's turned up a copy since, but it's been talked about. Grudge was the successor to Project Sign. Ruppelt wrote a book, The Report on Unidentified Flying Objects, also published in 1956. He says people asked him about the name Grudge. Was there any significance to it? He would tell them, no, it's just what we called it, what it ended up being called. But he tells the reader there was significance, plenty of it. And at the end of Project Grudge, there was an episode at Monmouth, New Jersey, Air Force Base there. I believe it was an Air Force Base. And a radar operator was given a demonstration of radar in front of some big brass. And something came in that moved at incredible speed. He didn't know what it was. And inquiries were made. Grudge was alerted. And they didn't respond as quite as the brass expected. And a couple of guys came forward and said, look, these guys aren't taking this seriously. And this really made some higher-ups angry. And they said, this is your job. You're supposed to be protecting our airspace, helping us protect our airspace. You should be investigating these things seriously. So the word was out that you've got to get this together. Captain Ruppelt, Edward Ruppelt, was tasked with the job, saddled with it. It wasn't exactly a gig that would enhance somebody's career at the time. He had a lot of integrity and he did the best job he could wherever you put him. The first thing he had to do was take these files that were tied up with strings out of boxes and put them in the proper file cabinets. That's what a shambles it was. Then he organized it, made connections with weather services. They also had a contract with Battelle, a think tank, and he got them to work on a cross-index computer program. So he put a lot of work into getting Blue Book going as well as it could. And he was also open-minded and he would let people go if he thought they were too pro-saucer or too anti-saucer. After him, the next guy, I think it was Stacker, was really anti. The closest guy to Ruppelt was Colonel Robert Friend. And J. Allen Hynek, he was the consultant for Close Encounters of the Third Kind and has a cameo in the movie. He was the scientific consultant. He was an astronomer. He taught at Northwestern University. He was head of the astronomy department there, I believe. And he was a scientific consultant all the way through, from Project Sign all the way to the end of Project Blue Book. Friend impressed Hynek more than anybody else. He said, very even-handed, steady guys. He looked at it with an open mind, in other words. So what my main finding is that it depended on who was in charge, which way the thing would go, and how the reports were written, and whether it was just PR, dealing with, there's a quote from somebody at Project Blue Book saying, it isn't the saucers that give us problems, it's the people. So there were a lot of nut jobs coming out of the woodwork and just hoaxers, etc. I mean, it turned into a circus and you had the contactees on top of this. So, it ended up, if I'm being sympathetic to the Air Force, it ended up a really public relations nightmare. So the guys that were thought this was nonsense and ridiculous would just get them off our back, get the press off our back. It's swamp gas. It's ball lightning. It's Venus, whatever. The very last guy to run Project Blue Book was Hector Quintanilla. And he was really anti, and he would write things off in any case. There was a case where a police officer and his partner, and the police officer's name was Dale Spar. They chased an object, what he described as a physical object. It had a fin and an antenna, and chased it all the way across the state of Ohio into Pennsylvania at speeds of, I think, up to 80 miles an hour. It's a very prominent case. Quintanilla, his first contact with Spar, was calling him on the telephone and saying, so tell me about this mirage you saw. And it went downhill from there. He only interviewed him for about 2.5 minutes. Another call was even shorter. And people started raising hell about this. I think a congressman got involved and they really pressured Quintanilla to get down there and do an interview. He did an interview and still wrote it up as you saw a satellite and it moved and then your eyes fixated on Venus and you chased Venus across the state of Ohio. So that was Quintanilla and he stuck to it. And James McDonald, who we mentioned before, well, you asked me what I found. That's what I found. There are cases that were investigated seriously and there are good files and you could call an honest, earnest investigation. And then there are cases that are just them trying to get rid of it, make it go away. And I also, you pick up, look at your Project Blue Book, that they're making it up as they go along. And it's also that, you know, they're military. Finding a scientific approach to flying saucers, well, they had consultants, but they are a military mindset. So I look at it as a very clumsy and awkward investigation for the most part. And often it just turned into a PR exercise.
What were some of the methods or tools used by UFO investigators to explore and validate the existence of spaceships and alien beings?
They never did. Most witness interviews, looking for trace evidence, landing marks, they do show up. Pictures were big. The April Bulletin ended up being letterpress printed, and the pictures would come out looking really good. They have a lot of interesting pictures in their publications. And best things were getting police reports. I look at the police as being the frontline investigators. They're often the first people called by citizens who see strange things. So they would collect the evidence as best as they could. Witness reports were the major thing, but unfortunately, that's all anecdotal. But coming up with documentation like a police report, police reports do show up in some of the files. A lot of the times, the police were very forthcoming because it's kind of a jurisdictional thing. Often with the police, it's their territory. They're local. This is a local problem. We want somebody who's going to deal with it. It depends on how they feel about the Air Force at the time. They'll either turn it over or they won't. But generally, police in general seem to have been mostly cooperative.
Should viewers of Paranormal Yakker want to buy the Flying Saucer Investigators, how did they do that?
Amazon.com. It's available in Kindle, audiobook, hardcover, softcover. So Amazon.com, Charles Lear, the Flying Saucer Investigators. You can see my weekly blog at podcastufo.com, a written version, Martin Willis's YouTube channel, Martin Willis Podcast UFO YouTube. So I do an audio version of the written blog as well.
Charles Lear, thank you for being my guest on Paranormal Yakker. I wish you much success with your book.
Well, thank you so much, Stan. It's been a pleasure talking with you.
Hi, everyone. This is Stan Mallow, the Paranormal Yakker. I hope you enjoyed part one of my interview with Charles Lear. In part two, he'll reveal how UFO investigators interacted with each other, the rivalry between them, how experiencers were affected by their encounters, and the next chapter in the UFO phenomena. To be sure you don't miss part two of my interview with Charles or any of my other upcoming interviews, be sure to subscribe to my free YouTube channel. All you have to do is press the subscribe button on your screen.